We have sort of the usual collection of stuff on the agenda today. Current release viewer candidates. At the moment, I think the only one we have out there is the login changes. Yeah, that's correct. That's the but there are a couple of others in the pipeline that are coming very, very soon. So you'll be seeing those presently. But to skip over those for just a minute, there are three project viewers out. The two that were out last week, Oculus Rift and Experience Tools. And we've added a new one, special just for Tankmaster. It is being called the benchmark viewer, but it is the end of the GPU table. No more GPU table. So,
that wouldn't have anything to do with the six jars I just filed with it.
No, we've been trying to get that done for months. It just happened that it would. So what that means is that if there is not a setting established, and we need to guess what your default graphic setting should be. So the first time you launch it on a clean install, for example, what it actually does is does a measurement of how quickly it can copy data back and forth into the memory between the memory on your GPU and your system's main memory. It turns out that that's a pretty good way to guess how good your GPU is. And there are a couple of other heuristics applied. There are some models of and combinations of video card and operating system version on the Mac that produce bogus results for that measurement. So we sort of take if the results are outside of a reasonable range, we just assume that you need a low graphics setting. Since that turns out to be appropriate on those versions. There may be one or two other little heuristics being applied, but the idea is to take a good guess at how good your video card is and set your default graphics level at that. Of course, if you manipulate that graphics level in any way, then your manipulation takes precedence and is stored for future use, right? So, as usual. So, the only time that you would go back to that default is if you wiped out your settings or told it you wanted to go back to the default or we made some major change that made us think that it was a good time to guess again. So, that's going out as a project viewer now. Anybody who would like to try it out and see what it guesses for what your default graphics setting ought to be and provide feedback about it, please do. That it's wonderful. So the, you know, it's on the alternate viewers page. It should be, yeah.
Okay.
And,
just a quick question. What is that going to mean for people with older viewers? Or not older viewers, but older computers?
It will pick a pretty low graphics setting for you. You know, something medium or below. I think that asking for it to reset your graphics setting will rerun the benchmark. Yes, I'm not sure. So, yeah, it is not true that we're going to always pick the setting you would have picked for yourself. Because depending on what your interest in is, you may have very different preferences. If you really want a smoothly rendered high performance experience, you're going to prefer that we guess low. And if you want something that's really blinged out and beautiful, then you're going to probably think that we're guessing too low instead of too high. Our goal really is to get something that's at least reasonable, and to stop making the pretty terrible mistake of somebody goes out and buys a really nice new graphics card and puts it in, and because it's not recognized, they end up getting locked into really lame low settings. So that's the case we really hate and want to fix. So, yeah, I don't know. Anytime you're in a busy place, you ought to turn your settings down. For some reason, I find I have to turn my settings down whenever I'm at the server user group meeting. I don't know what it is about the people who show up there, but I always find my performance is terrible at that meeting. So that's out there. Assuming, what we would like to do is get some wider experience with that on more different machines than we've got in our QA lab. And get the feedback, as Grumpity said, and then that will move in one form or another into the release candidate phase and eventually become the standard.
As those of us that are beta testers with the Firestorm, are you asking that we actually help participate in that with providing us some bugs?
Yeah, feel free. Right. I mean, it'd be great to just get what we're looking for mostly is examples of cases where it made a really bad pick. Right. And if you're going to report something on it, it would be really good if you attached a log file so that we could look at the internals. The other two there, other than the routine updates of merging what's releasing, I don't think anything very dramatic has happened. There is a batch of fixes to experiences that are going to the simulator next week. Nothing huge, but a bunch of things that have been in RC and they're going to get promoted.
Question asked, Oz.
Yeah.
You mentioned fixes. I do hope, and I'm not the only one, that this will include a fix of group chat, because we at Virtual Ability have pretty lame.
Right. Well, I'll get to where we are in group chat in a minute. Okay. So let me just hold off on that. I want to finish with the. No, that's fine. I definitely want to talk about that. Other things that are going on, we'll have an HTTP pipelining viewer. Monty's famous HTTP pipelining viewer will be coming out as a release candidate as soon as it's gotten out of QA. So that's coming real soon. Yeah, probably Monday or Tuesday, whatever. So very much looking forward to that. Be looking at that as something you're going to want to port to third-party viewers because it's way better. Yes, the pipelining is compatible with the CDN. We have tested it. And in fact, the CDN is better at handling the pipelining than our servers are. So the combination is very synergistic. Really, yeah, there we go. When we deployed the first few test regions, I cleared my cache and logged in, and all the textures had been fetched before the black login screen went away. It was pretty cool. This region, so we have at the moment we have 10 regions in the CDN mesh and texture downloads tests. And that includes this one, the one you're in now. You're soaking in it. For those of you old enough to remember that line. And also Hippo Hollow, the adjacent sandbox region. We will eventually look at other viewer consumable assets. Yeah, there we go. Is that all 10 of them? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Yeah. And there are there's a few more that will get added over the next week or so, we think. So that's all coming, and it's so far it's working just great. So that's a really big deal. And it should be especially useful for people who have long ping times. That's where you'll really notice the difference. There's a batch of viewer voice fixes that will be coming out, I expect, next week. Yeah, we have, if anybody knows the owner of Bear Rose, we have sent the owner of Bear Rose a message saying, do you want to participate? And have not gotten an answer. So, the only really pathological regions we've tested it on are our own texture torture test regions, which it did great on. Yeah, well, we didn't want to flip anybody into this particular test at this stage without talking to them about it. So we're waiting for that to happen. The ping time, somebody can answer that better than I can.
Statistics bar, control shift 1. Brings up the statistics bar and your ping sim time is in there.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, ping sim, right. So mine right this minute is 141 milliseconds. And my ping time to the CDN node is about 20 milliseconds. That's 789. Wow. Where are you going to see a difference?
Yeah, well, as soon as you start talking about ping, I wanted to look at it. Oh, it's back down to about 280 now. It was up over 850 now.
Yeah, but
I don't know what's going to... I mean, the lag in the viewer right now is just ridiculous.
Yeah, so try...
I can barely type. It took about 15 seconds to type 789 now.
Yeah, so if you want to get a preview of your ping time, to just do a command window and ping that, and that'll give you your ping time to the nearest CDN node. Yeah. Right. So that's 45 is actually relatively long for that. So yeah, so that's where that is. That's as we said, that's on 10 regions now. It'll probably go on a few more over the next week or so. And eventually we will roll it out onto one of the regular big three RC release candidates and eventually the whole grid. So watch for developments. There's a batch of voice fixes that will be coming out in a viewer probably next week, that are all very nice things to have. Some of them are not obviously problems for the users, but they are all things that have bad effects on the Vivox servers. So if we could get people to merge those quickly, then Vivox would appreciate it a lot. And it will generally make voice more robust, and it'll make, in particular, it will reduce the number of spurious errors in their logs, which will make it easier for them to find the errors that we're not finding now. So it's one of those do it because it's good for everybody if we do it. Thanks.
Does that involve viewer code as well as the files?
Yes, those are just viewer code, actually.
Okay.
They mostly have to do with fixes to how connections get cleaned up at logout and some similar issues. There's an anti-stalking fix in there. That's nice. So those are all good. The Hover Height project is actually getting attention and work done on it. So that's coming. Is Veer here somewhere?
Yep, I'm here.
Yeah. Veer is working on that. So it's early stages yet, but we're getting there, right?
Yep, coming along.
So I explained where are we putting the UI? I don't know. What did we settle on that, Veer?
Yeah, the right-click menu for your avatar will have
an
option.
It's most likely the place where it'll be.
We're tweaking hover height according to the latest spec, yeah.
Okay. Yeah, it is not persistent. No.
Yeah, this is all early stages, so anything we say... may turn out not to be the case ultimately, but that's
right.
That's what we're currently targeting.
But it is not at present our goal to make it persistent, other than through your session. It is not persistent between sessions. No, it's not hooked to a debug setting.
Yeah, we do have the shape parameter hover already, and the current thing that we're working on is basically intended as hopefully the sort of final fix-up on top of the pile of fix-ups that we already have for this stuff, in cases where hover doesn't quite get you where you want to be.
Right, just see our set.
I assume that it's going to be slightly more granular than the hover is, right?
Probably. We're currently looking at it as a float, so it should give you a little finer finer control than the having an 8-bit slider.
Okay. Just because that's the major problem that we've encountered with our users with the hover setting is, you know, I'm this much above the ground. Some people are pretty picky, right?
Yeah, it is. the current setting is sort of quantized because it's getting, you know, crammed down into an 8-bit parameter. The current thing is not a parameter at all. It's going to be an additional piece of data that's passed around probably as a float, so we shouldn't have the same granularity issues. Allowing modification of hover for no mod shapes, the new parameter will be modifiable by anybody. It doesn't go through the shape mechanism at all, so it doesn't matter whether your shape allows you to change your hover value there or not. But it's a new quantity that's basically persisted, you know, just per session, and people would have to tweak it again when they log back in.
Yeah. Thank so the idea is that this is a parameter that gets applied after everything in your shape has been applied, and it's just an attribute of the avatar, not an attribute an ephemeral attribute of the avatar that lasts only as long as you're logged in. I guess you could tie it to a debug setting. You could force the debug setting to match whatever it had been set to. That's an interesting idea.
Yeah, but I'll look into that. If there's not any specific reason not to, we might want to go that way.
Yeah, we'll have to think about that. Well, if you could essentially putting it in a debug savings setting, yeah, it would have to be per account, right? Not if we did that, it would last across sessions, but
only as long as you're using the same, you know,
as long as you're using the same viewer on the same machine, right? Or at least the same settings file.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's an interesting idea. Let's see. So that's coming along. We don't have any predicted dates for that as usual, but we are working on it. So people who are not happy with how they are positioned vertically can begin to hope. Yeah. Group chat. I said I'd get back to group chat. So you will probably have noticed that over the last few weeks there have not been a lot of noticeable improvements in group chat. If so, your observation is correct. We are going to get, we think that's mostly because the deployment of group chat specific improvements has been blocked by some other things that had to be deployed on the same hosts, and those things we think are now done. So we will begin trying out new experiments next week sometime. I'm not going to predict when, mostly because I don't want you to know when, and also because I really don't know. But we should be able to get some stuff out next week. I mean, it's been ready for quite a while, and just waiting its turn to get onto the servers. So we have deployed some things that we think will make the servers more robust. I don't want you to know, because if I tell you when there's been a change, then you'll decide that something is different. And what I want you to know is just notice that something is different when it really is, not because you were looking for a change. It's just, you know, keeping it an at least single blind experiment. It has certainly been our experience that when we we make an announcement that we've changed XYZ, we begin getting lots of problem reports that attribute various difficulties to the fact that we deployed XYZ. Often they are completely unrelated. Occasionally they are related. That's good. Jan? Actually, that scrolled my window off.
I've got something to bring up involving group chat as well, but I don't know if you're going to bring it up now or wait until later.
Now is as good a time as any, I guess.
All right. We've had a lot of instances lately of the servers just choking, ports getting filled up.
The chat servers, you mean?
The chat servers.
Yes, for group chat in particular. That's what we've been waiting for the fixes for.
Okay. The thing that I wanted to bring up, though, is you have to be a premium member to report that, and it's a server-side issue. There's absolutely nothing the user can do about it. Is there any way of moving that so that a non-premium member can report it on a Jira or in to the support team?
You're out of my...
I'm out of your bailiwick, and Izzy's not here. Yeah.
Yeah, Izzy couldn't make it today. He does plan on coming most of the time, but he's caught up in other things today, so he couldn't make it.
Okay, well, I was asked to bring that one up by some of our team members and a bunch of other people because it's terribly, terribly critical for a lot of places like ourselves, Virtual Ability, and a lot of the support groups.
Right. I think that the problem that has led to the servers just freezing up or appearing to freeze up, stop communicating. We think that the major cause of that has been addressed. So we'll see over there. And I think it's only actually been deployed on some of the servers so that we can compare what we're seeing on the ones where we've deployed the fix and the ones where we haven't. Assuming that that goes well, it will get rolled to the rest of them quickly. I really can't. There's really nothing I can do to help you with the who's allowed to talk to who problem. We're just not in my space at that point. I am on the blind side of the blind experiment here, so I don't actually know which servers are the ones that have had the fix deployed to them. Listen, we could spend all a lot of time on the inadequacy of communication or the inadequacy of support, and there still wouldn't be anything I could do much about. That's not really what we're here to deal with today. And I'm not the right person. Open a JIRA to get the support categories adjusted. It wouldn't hurt to make a suggestion. Whether or not it will work is not something I'm prepared to predict. But we'll read it, for sure. We read them all.
Yeah, I just actually wanted to make a note, since the subject came up, that bugs get triaged most of the time on the same day. Sometimes it takes a couple of days, especially after the weekend. And feature requests get triaged every 2 weeks. So don't hesitate to file a JIRA if what's holding you back is the expectation that it won't get looked at. That's not true.
It really isn't true. We really read them all.
Okay, thanks for that. My only concern would be that it would be considered maybe the wrong place to ask, and like closed as out of scope or something like that, with no real clear direction on where to go next. And
right.
So I just kind of want to avoid that. Hoops, if I could.
That does happen sometimes, because sometimes it is the wrong place to go. Right.
We try to be thorough in our responses, but sometimes we fail due to being human. But we try.
You're human? Who said that?
I have a quick question on this. Would it be better for those that are non-premium members to just simply file a ticket through the support ticket
You know what? If Izzy was here, he might be able to have answered that, but I actually couldn't tell you one way or the other whether that's better or worse.
Well, the reason I'm asking, Oz, is because sometimes Life Support as a premium member, has instructed me to file a ticket before they can provide any help. So that was what I was asking.
I actually haven't got the faintest idea whether that would be helpful or not. Or harmful.
Well,
just don't ever deal with that side of the. I can't even log into the system where those tickets go.
So we are trying to find ways to reduce friction. Where if a ticket can be handled through support, it will be. However, sometimes there are issues that support just can't help with, and where engineers need to kind of go back and forth with you to figure out what's going on. In those cases, support can't just send it to the engineers and then come back to you, because they need additional information directly from you, and it's just more effective that way. But in cases where it's a one-off question, we are trying to streamline that process. So for the chat servers issue, I think you still need to continue going through support.
Yeah.
If I can just say something, I'm going to tell you what a Linden, who I will not name, has suggested to me. And that is that you file a support ticket and a JIRA on it at the moment until things get fixed.
Yeah. Well, hopefully the until things get fixed is not going to be very long, as at least relative to how long the problem has been going on. So, and we will be doing some other things that we think will probably make a significant difference in the ordinary chat performance of group chat. And there will probably be more changes after that. So we're still actively seized of the issue. We have had a little bit of a pause here the last few weeks where we've been trying to deal with this system level problem. So, anyway, we're trying. So I guess that was the agenda. Oh yeah, Abby's asking us about group chat on a regular basis, actually. So don't worry, it's not forgotten. I have not noticed that Abby forgets things very easily, actually. The floor is open for other non-group chat related issues.
Jess isn't here, so there's probably not going to be a lot.
Actually, I had one with regards to content creators. Have you actually got anything in the works for helping to improve the ability of preventing copybotting?
No, not really.
That's something that I hear a lot within the content creator groups is that there's still a large concern about content creators with regards to copybotting.
Right. Well, it is mostly an intractable problem. It's not even a question whether or not the viewer is open source. The viewer is a consumer of the bits, and once you have sent the bits to the viewer, the bits are in the viewer, and you can get them back out. You can copy them off your video card with a utility that has absolutely no connection to the viewer at all. So, that's not a technology-solvable problem, I'm afraid.
It's sort of like dealing with griefers. I mean, people always say, why doesn't Linden Lab do more about griefers? And my standard response is, what do you want them to do? You want them to ban by a MAC address, IP address? How else are you going to ban them? And you can't really do both. You can't do either effectively.
We translations are happy to get feedback on the translations. We do have a policy of always running translation changes through the professional translators. We pay for that sort of thing, and if they disagree with you about what the right translation is, then generally speaking they win. Unless it's one of the languages one of us speaks idiomatically. I don't know what that, let's see, 73-12. Oh, yeah.
I have an answer for that. We stopped supporting Danish and Polish about a year ago. So those translations actually are not getting updated, unfortunately. And therefore, we will actually probably remove those languages from the viewer in the near future. Because we don't have the updated translations for all of them. Thank you. There is another round of translations, but not for Polish and Danish. I can't say what the policy would be for languages that we've stopped supporting if there's someone who is willing to contribute translations regularly, but I can check for you.
Yes, translations are can be a nuisance. Well, are we done? Can we all get 15 minutes back?
Actually, Oz, there was something with regards to that I was asking. Regarding QuickTime, has there been anything done with regards to QuickTime?
No, the project we would be thinking about doing something with QuickTime on is the CEF project, but at the moment that's on hold in favor of upgrading all the tools we use for building viewers. We're in the process of upgrading to Xcode 6, and it was 5, but they went and released 6 while we were doing it, so we've changed to 6. And Visual Studio 2013.
How's that coming with the work with regards to Visual Studio 2013?
Visual Studio 2013 is a bit behind the Xcode 6 effort. Mostly for reasons of getting the right build farm infrastructure in place, not necessarily because compiling with VS 2013 will be any harder, but it's not as far along.
And Rory's asking about Cocoa Bugs.
Yeah, but. you guys can keep asking about them. Go ahead.
Personally, with Cocoa Bugs, personally, I would just use a good insecticide.
I hesitate to predict how long it's going to take us to get through the tool chain thing. We're changing auto build and Visual Studio and Xcode all at the same time. We saw that. The alt cam one there are still instances of that we haven't figured out. The keystroke entry lag, we think, is a system problem that has nothing to do with anything we were doing. Incidentally, if anybody is running into that a lot, I have found that on the few occasions when I've encountered the keystroke entry echo lag problem, and I have hit it a few times, turning off advanced lighting makes it much better. So I tend to have it when I'm in very memory intensive Second Life circumstances and turning off the fancier rendering, which I normally leave on even though my machine's not really up to it, makes a big difference. We'll be glad to try the contributions, Cinder. That'd be great. I am personally a bit behind on reviewing and integrating contributions, and I apologize for that, but this tools project has just got me swamped. Yeah, well, I mean, you should upgrade to the latest version of Mavericks. It's way better. 10.9.5 just came out. The upgrade was trivial. I even upgraded my ancient Mac Mini to it, and it works great. We really do see, I mean, I'll repeat what I've said in the blog post, and in other places, people on the latest, OSs do have significantly better crash rates than people who aren't.
Except for Windows 8.
Well, Windows 8.1.
8.1 is, I'm saying.
8.1 is way better than 8.0.
Yeah, 7 does better than 8, and 8.1 does better than both.
Right. Right. 8 was a bit of a regression there.
And oops.
No, they meant, yeah, iOS, yeah. Oh, good. We need a new target platform. Go ahead, Gibson.
Is it going to gracefully adjust without interfering with the playing animations? That's a good question. At this point, we're still in the early stages. You know, the likely mechanism is going to be that, you know, when you change this, you're going to send the update to the sim through a new message, or you know, your viewer will, and then that'll get sent out to other viewers via an appearance message. So how smoothly that's going to interleave with other pieces of information that are coming in, I think is probably going to depend on the particular case, but we'll kind of have to see once we're a little farther along.
The one thing that I think that I understand to not be a goal is that if I'm in the process of moving my slider up and down and I haven't taken my finger off the mouse button yet to establish a new setting, then I should see my avatar moving, but nobody else should until I've released it and said, that's the setting I'm going to put it at. We don't want to send out a whole stream of updates so that everybody sees you moving vertically while you're adjusting.
Yeah. Yeah. We certainly don't want to be spamming a ton of updates out. That's, you know.
So it's like the appearance editor. When I begin editing my appearance, you don't see it until I'm done.
I mean, I think things should work okay with animations. Basically, you're just adding an additional offset to your avatar's position that kind of goes on top of everything else. So, you know, exactly when that gets tossed into the stream, you know, since addition commutes, it should be okay. But
right, since we couldn't figure out how to make the current gigantic convoluted collection of things that adjust your vertical position come out perfectly for all the possible circumstances, we just decided to add one more to it. And
because that's always the solution to everything.
So it's the best we could come up with, really. Okay, well, I think we're at the end of our time. So we're going to switch to the hanging around, chatting on the ground phase of the get-together.
Woo.
I'm with you there, Grumpy.
Thanks, folks.
Thanks, all.
Thanks, us.
Have a good weekend, everybody.
And poof.
Hey, Oz.
And congrats, Grumpy.
You're welcome.
Was Grumpy with Product Engine before?
Hi, Lassie.
Hey, that's
Spanish.
Live long and prosper.